Welcome to another episode on yet another electronics channel. Well, after I did now a bunch of videos about audio DSP stuff on the STM32, it's finally time to switch the platform to the ESP32. Now you might wonder why I'm doing this. Well, the answer is that the ESP32 is also quite a powerful platform, which is comparable at least also with an ARM Cortex-M4, for example. You have good availability of like all the ESP32 boards. They are also cheap and you have good community support. But before we are starting now all the DSP videos on the ESP32 now, let's have a look on the most basic question, how you can set up the I2S to an input and output configuration to use it with an ADC and also with an DAC. So just to have a look now on the system overview, what I have implemented now for you as a code example is basically that I'm using my standard input-output audio board, the I2S2 PMOD board, and I have connected here to the ESP32, and the ESP32 is like generating also all the clocks, including also the master clock, is putting the audio stream into the software, which is doing like a monosum and then just looping back the audio to the output and pushing it out over the DAC. If you have a look now on the official documentation, you can see that there is an I2S driver provided, but the code examples are not that meaningful actually, because I have shown only code examples how to use the driver in transmit configuration, and it also doesn't show you how to configure the master clock, which is basically needed by a lot of ADCs or DACs. And also a good thing to tell at this point is that the ESP32 has basically two I2S modules, which are both usable in a bidirectional configuration. So if you want to, you can set up an input-output configuration where you have like four input streams and four output streams theoretically. But now the question, how to set up the master clock. Well, the ESP32 I2S driver is not supporting the configuration of the master clock itself. But if you have a look on the technical reference manual, you can see here the I2S clock tree. And you see also that the bit clock output, which you are using for your I2S module, is basically derived from some kind signal called here I2SN clock. And this is going to be your master clock afterwards. But in the standard driver, the signal here just stays internally. So you have to configure somehow the outputs that you can also use this internal clock signal also on output and not just the bit clock signal. And if you have now a look on the I/O multiplexer pad list, you see that at least on GPI 0, 1 and 3, we have here signals which are called clock out 1, clock out 3 and clock out 2. And yeah, well, what do you have to do to use or to route the internal clock signal as master clock output signal to the output? For this one time, we have the I/O multiplexer GPIO 0 control register where you can set up which signal the GPIO 0 should output. And this has to be set to, for example, clock 1, but you're free, you can also use maybe clock 0 or clock 2 also. And then also on the other side, we have to route that internal I2S0 internal clock signal to the clock out 1 basically, so that this is afterwards being routed to the outside world via the IO max GPIO 0 register in this case. And well, now let's have a look how you can set up the driver together with the master clock. Here, this is the standard driver configuration for the ESP32. And in my case, I have used here the master mode, including transmit and also receive in 44.1 kilohertz configuration and with a bit length of 32. And then we are just configuring here like the DMA buffer length, which is basically 512 samples, not bytes, it means samples in this case. Then we are installing here our driver, then we are configuring here our pins. And then in the end, here very at the end, we are configuring here our registers for having the master clock. So this means that we have one time to write the pin, pin control. That it outputs like the clock out or that it routes the internal I2S clock to the clock out 1 signal, and then afterwards we have to select the function clockout 1 on the GPIO 0 in this case. Yeah, but now to the most interesting question, what is the speed of this master clock we are generating here? So if you have a look on the I2S driver of the ESP32, you see that there is a I2S set clock function, which is basically also called one time when you're just initializing your driver. So you can see that it forces either 250 times the sampling rate or either 384 times the sampling rate. But this depends basically on your bit length of the samples. But in our case, if you have like 32 bit, it will end up like in 256 times configuration of the sampling frequency. So all the code programming I have done with the ESP IDF framework under a virtual Linux machine basically. And yeah, basically, as I have shown you already, this is like all the configuration for the I2S and so on. Here you have like the configuration of the master clock signal on GPIO 0. And then we are starting here our while loop. And it just starts here with the command I2S read. And it is just transmitting here the data all in that RX buffer I have just initialized here at this point. And yeah, for the second parameter here, you can see you just give the parameter how many samples do you want to read. But it is a little bit, let's say, awkward, because here at this point for the DMA configuration, you have to give the DMA buffer length in terms of sample size. So this means 512 samples, but at this time or at this point, it means like the size in terms of bytes. So if you want to read 256 samples, this means you have to multiply it by 4, because every sample has like 4 bytes in the end. And yeah, this just a timeout. And if this function returns ESP OK and the read size was like really 256 samples, then you have like all the samples stored in your RX buffer. So it is slightly another concept in comparison with the STM32, where you have like your half complete callback or like your full complete callback. So it's a little bit working the other way. So basically there's also like a DMA behind who is like copying all the data from the I2S module to the software back and forth. But you can think like a little bit that this driver works kind of a FIFO buffer. So think of it like there is a FIFO buffer behind and you're just reading the samples out of the FIFO buffer into your RX buffer in this case. Yeah, and this is just for extracting the stereo samples to my mono buffers that I have on time, a left sample input buffer and the right input sample buffer. Then I'm applying here my doing mono signals, so I'm just summing up the samples and multiply it with 0.5 that I have like a minus 6 dB gain at this point. And then I'm merging the two sample buffers once again together in like a mixed buffer to restore like the buffer which is being fed into the I2S hardware back then afterwards. And then I'm just writing here I2S write TX buffer and also like the number of bytes or samples, how you want to call it. And yeah, this is basically all. So this is now my test setup. You can see here the ESP32, which has my code programmed onto it, which I have shown you. And he has connected the PMOD I2S2 board, and the input is connected here to my smartphone, and the output is basically connected here to my desktop loudspeaker system. And if I play now the music, you can just hear the audio loopback through the ESP32.